Good morning. Thanks for getting up to listen to me talk about this. Who knows what Cloudbleed is? Were people aware of it before they came in here? Great. So I will talk a little bit about Cloudflare. I will talk a little bit about Cloudbleed itself, and then about the sequence of events internally at the company and what we did subsequently after this happened. So first of all, to talk a little bit about Cloudflare. Cloudflare operates a network of approximately 150 points of presence around the world where we proxy traffic, primarily HTTP and HTTPS traffic, although actually other sorts of traffic as well proxied through us. And we do this for three main reasons. One is for performance reasons, so we operate a CDN type service. For security reasons, we are fairly well known for doing DDoS mitigation and also for application firewalling. And second of all, we provide availability. And the goal of Cloudflare is to get as close to end users in the world as possible. That's why there are so many locations. We try to be about 10 milliseconds from the global population. So there's still more build out for our network, obviously in West Africa, some areas in South America, but we're getting close to covering the online population. And in those data centers, we operate a single stack of software. It's identical and horizontally scales across the world. And that software had a flaw, which caused Cloudbleed, and of course it caused it everywhere in the world. What was Cloudbleed? So the simple version of what was Cloudbleed was we were leaking memory from our machines into the output of HTTP requests. So people would visit web pages, and the web pages would be corrupted. You'd get most of the page, and then you'd get something else, which was memory. And it was memory from the machines that are running in our network. And the big problem with this is that our infrastructure is highly shared. There's about 8 million websites that run on Cloudflare going through the same machines. So what you were seeing was essentially someone else's memory for a request that was being processed. And the process requests could have been from decrypted HTTPS sessions. So you could also have been seeing something that was unobservable on the wire as well. So it was a very, very scary thing to have happen because you were pushing this stuff out. The second thing that was happening is because it was HTTP or HTTPS, some of this was purely public and therefore was being cached by search engines. And so some of this data was being cached around the world. It's not a very exciting bug in the sense that we're just running past the end of a buffer and then running into the rest of the memory. And what sorts of things were in memory? Well, entire HTTP requests, so cookies, authentication tokens, the bodies of post requests, other sensitive stuff. And all of that was potentially getting cached by search engines. And essentially what got dumped depended on how far the software ran until it found something it liked and stopped dumping memory, because in fact it was looking for valid HTML. So my pro tip is don't ever do this. Don't leak random chunks of memory onto the internet. You'll have a very, very bad week if you do that. If you do that, definitely don't then have them cached by search engines around the world, because you will discover that there are a large number of search engines that do web page caching. You'll also discover that Google is by far the best. When we did the cleanup for this, it was interesting to look at the number of pages that were cached by different search engines. And honestly, Google is by far the best at search. But around the world, there are lots of search engines. And if you go to a search engine and tell them that you've made this mistake, they don't necessarily have a process for cleaning this up. This is not an obvious thing, right? So you have to try and figure out who can go in and invalidate those cache entries. And they may think you're making it up, right? That this is not something you should be doing. So just to take you back to what this is. So this is February of last year. So just to talk about what actually happened. So I've put the times in UTC mostly for my own benefit because I work at Cloudflare in London, so most of this happened to me in the middle of the night. But Tavis Omondi from Project Zero tweeted, could someone from Cloudflare contact me urgently? This is both a terrifying thing to read and a very good thing to read. We would be much happier that someone like Tavis found this than random hacker on the internet. So whilst it was absolutely terrifying, when you see a security researcher say, I found something terrifying about your service, a whole team jumped on it and we got working on it because clearly this was something we had to stop quickly. So that was about 11, just past midnight UTC, and skipped over one. And about 20 minutes later, we actually had the details from Tablet. So he sent us a clear explanation, a reproducible test case where we could actually hit a particular URL and see the corrupted page. It took about 20 minutes. So that was just contacting him and getting it back. And about 8 minutes later, we had a team assembled. So we have an InfoSec team, which is based in San Francisco. And we have folks in the UK as well. And so as soon as that happened, so it took us about 30 minutes from that tweet to the whole team is there, everyone's working on it. And it's about this time that they called me and woke me up and said, there's something very, very bad happening. And by about, by 1:20, we'd stopped the leak. So it took us an hour and something to stop the leak. Because we were working with somebody like Tavis who gave us a clear reproducible case, it was very easy to go into the code and go, this is where the problem is, and we can then test it and stop it. And this was caused by, there were a number of features that caused this problem. We have a feature called email obfuscation. So in the early history of Cloudflare, one of the things we did a lot of was around email spam. And so we would obscure email addresses that appear on web pages. And then we'd make them appear if someone clicked on them. So it stops a bot from getting the page. That requires you to parse the HTML as it passes through us. So if you imagine someone visits a website that uses Cloudflare, we go to the origin server, we get the HTML, and as it comes back through, we parse through looking for email addresses. It was in that parser that there was a problem. The parser was not stopping at the end of the page, it was overrunning and dumping memory into the output. We disabled it. We have feature flags for everything. This is a big lesson for me, was having a feature flag for everything is very valuable because we were able to globally kill individual features. And so we just turned it off. And Tavis got back to us and said, yep, we don't see that anymore. About 3 minutes later, we had the team in London awake. This is the actual text message I received. Worst security issues ever. And given the guy who sent that to me, he doesn't exaggerate. So I was awake instantaneously when that happened. We started to look at manually inspecting the code to see if there were other areas where the same problem could be occurring, because the parser is used for multiple things. And it took us a few hours. So at 4 o'clock in the morning, there was another feature which we disabled worldwide. So we upgrade people's web pages to use HTTPS if they enable that feature. So they can enable a feature which we will parse the page as it goes through. Anything that uses an HTTP link, if we can turn it into HTTPS, we will. So again, we're parsing the page and modifying it. That had the same effect. And then we made a horrible discovery about 7 a.m., which was we didn't have a kill switch for an ancient feature in Cloudflare. So Cloudflare has a feature which allows you to mark part of a web page as something that should never be shown to a bad visitor. So if we suspect you of being a bot, we'll hide that part of the page. It was one of the first features at Cloudflare and before we put in feature flags. And so we didn't have a feature flag for it, so we couldn't turn it off. And so we implemented a kill switch for it and did a software deployment globally, and then were able to turn it off. So it took us the bad, very high rate of leaking memory. It was off immediately, because that was the email obfuscation feature that was very quickly dealt with. These other ones were lesser used features, and they were on a smaller number of websites. So they were not as high impact, but there was some continuous bleeding going on. One thing to note here is the reason that I know all these dates and times and everything is one of the things that we did immediately this happened was started keeping a record of what was going on. And it was very important to immediately keep knowledge about what we're doing, what we were keeping. So we had a shared chat room where people were discussing what was happening, but I was sitting in London with an Emacs buffer open, keeping a record of this is what we did at a particular time. Because if you got a situation like this, especially where you're leaking customer information, and it was live, right? It wasn't like a database has been leaked and it's gone. It was actually, you know, someone could go to a web page. You get into a sort of fog of war situation where you don't know quite what's happening. People are trying out different things. Some people are half asleep, some are awake. It's very important to keep a record of it. And subsequently, the next morning, was when I started writing up the disclosure, because it's freshest in mind. What happened? What are the things? So we started to write up the public disclosure that we were going to do, and it would then get edited. What we didn't do, and there are two teams in Cloudflare that were very upset that we didn't do this, was we never told the PR department and we never told the legal department. So neither of them got informed until actually about almost a week later. So there were two things happening. One is stop the bug, make sure we've got another one like that, and then the big effort was clean up the search engines, because you had personal private information in search engine caches. So we made that, and then we went back to the legal team, and to his credit, the general counsel took it on the chin with a stiff upper lip and said, okay, this is what I'm dealing with, and the PR team also. But this was very much an engineering effort, and we kept it to a very small team inside the company who are operating it. Just to go into a little bit in the sort of technical side of things. So it's not a sort of a super exciting bug, but to give you an idea of how common it was. So we had these three features: email obfuscation, which was the most common, rewriting HTTPS, and server-side excludes. And if you had one of those three features enabled, and you had a web page that ended with broken HTML, and it specifically had to end with an attribute that was had the quote open and then was done. So what was happening was the parser would get to the end of the page and would find the attribute that started, and then would go looking for the rest of the attribute and would not find it, and it would overrun the end of the buffer. So a fairly simple bug. The tragic irony of all this is that the parser that this was using was something that had existed since the beginning of the company. We had identified it as a risky piece of software and were in the process of rewriting it when this occurred. So I guess we were right that it was risky. We did a bad job of actually getting it under control fast enough. This is kind of what it looked like. This is an actual web page that had a broken piece of HTML at the top, so at the bottom. So you can see the actual web page would come out, and then you'd get something at the bottom. And the reason that Project Zero found this is quite interesting. They want data for doing fuzzing of software. And one of the ways they do that is they're using the public cache in Google to look for interesting data that they can fuzz with. And when they were looking for interesting data, they're looking for things with a lot of entropy, and they found these strange pages with this stuff at the bottom. And within it, there are actually some clues that it's us, because there are internal headers that are between our systems that are being passed around, and also an internal key that was being used. And so that's why they contacted us. Just to go a little deeper into what happens, we used a parser based on a piece of technology called Regel, and in doing so, we wrote our own HTML parser, and we kind of screwed it up. So this is what happens if you had like a script tag where the attribute doesn't actually terminate. So what happens is it calls this thing, consume the attribute, which should go, it actually just skip over the attribute. And if it can't find it, then if it's done it, then it should move on. And if it can't find the end of the tag, then it has this thing where it says, well, I couldn't find the rest of the attribute. And critical to this is this fhold keyword there. So this is what happens in Regel is this turns into a C program, which we then compile. And it's just using standard kind of pointer arithmetic things. So what occurred in there was the fhold, so if we did find the end of the tag, we get to the quote, it would, after you've consumed a value, we then back up one byte, right? So you're right at the end at that point. If you didn't find the end of the tag, so you ran to the end of the buffer, we didn't actually back up, because if you look at the bottom piece where we do the f go to script consume attra, we didn't do an f hold. So that was our mistake. We didn't actually say, hey, you need to back up. And so what would happen, in the generated code, there was this test, which is go to the next byte. If we're at the end of the buffer, then we're done. Because we hadn't backed up, you jumped over the end of the buffer. That buffer test failed, and now you're off into past the end of the buffer. So a very, very classic, very, very classic bug. Now, what's interesting is, why did this start happening? Because this started happening in September, the prior September. But this piece of code had been in production for about 6 years and had not had this problem. So we were not leaking memory. So it suddenly happened. And we had not altered this particular piece of code either. Well, as I said before, we were in the process of writing a new HTML parser and getting rid of this old one. And what was happening was we were migrating features from the old one to the new one. Internally, we use Nginx. And you can see the history of Cloudflare. The actual HTML parsing function is called parse email, because originally it just parsed email addresses in HTML. And it passes in these buffers, right? It passes in a pointer to a buffer, which has got HTML in it. It tells you where the end of it is and whether you're at the end of the file. And, you know, as I say, the irony was we were trying to migrate away from this thing. Now, it was the insertion of the new parser that actually caused the old parser to fail, which is kind of a funny thing. But within Nginx, you're getting passed around a chain of buffers, which is where you've received the web page. And if the old parser was there, then you would have this last buff flag set to zero. So when you got to the end of when you actually got to the last buffer, it would actually say, I don't know that this is actually the last buffer. There could be more data coming. And it would rely on the pointers to actually figure out that it's the end of the buffer. What happened when the new parser was also present was it said, by the way, this is the last buffer. And this caused it, in fact, to overrun the end because it made a mistake with this last buffer thing. So what happened was the internal sort of feng shui of the buffers had changed, which revealed a bug that had been there for 6 years. I mean, this not checking the end of the buffer thing was correct. It just happened that because of the way in which we signaled whether you're on the last buffer or not, you actually did that check or didn't. And when you put the new one in, so in fact, we introduced this while trying to make our lives better. And this is just what it looked like. It just jumped, and then it ran past the end, and off you go. So, you know, what was, to talk about the sort of the good things, the bad things, and the really ugly things that happened during this entire process. You know, the good thing is we stopped it in 47 minutes, and I guess, you know, a lot of people internally congratulated themselves on, Tavis told us something, 47 minutes later, most of the leak was gone, right? So great, that was good. We dealt with it quickly. We had feature flags, we had a team that we knew how to assemble, we were able to get the right people together. Well, ironically, except for one guy. The guy who was writing the new parser had told me a week before that he was having difficulty sleeping because he had this recurring nightmare that I was going to call him in the middle of the night and tell him that his new code had brought down our service or created some security problem. And we couldn't actually get hold of him that night. He didn't answer the phone, ironically. So, you know, but, you know, we fixed it fairly quickly. But that was probably the only thing that was good here, right? The bad thing was we were leaking really sensitive stuff. So private key used to secure internal connectivity between our machines. So if you think about those 150 data centers around the world, all of our connectivity is TLS between those things, and we leaked the private key for that. Some internal authentication secrets. So a lot of stuff that was leaked was actually internal stuff in Cloudflare, so some internal authentication secrets. So we had to go off and invalidate stuff. So we had to very rapidly change keys and authentication stuff. But also, not just internal stuff, but also stuff from the outside world, right? So HTTP headers for customer websites, including cookies, right? Post data. You know, stuff could have been present. We were worried that we were going to find someone's password or a credit card number or a social security number. URI parameters, API calls, authentication secrets. So you can imagine, you know, there's also all sorts of stuff. And Tavis had actually snapshotted some stuff. So this was a very, very large wearable device manufacturer. You know, you wear a thing on your wrist to get fit. And, you know, this is the entire request that it had. He's blanked out authentication keys, but that, you know, this device was authenticating to their service and we were leaking. He saw that information when he was testing. We never saw this in a search engine, but he saw it because he repeatedly tried sucking down memory from us to see what he could get. A large dating website. So he saw a private message between two people on a large dating website. A large ride-hailing service. So the app on a phone talking to their back end, say, I need a car, I'm sitting here. So that was scary. Now, the good news is we didn't find this kind of stuff in search engines, but had someone other than Project Zero found this and exploited it, this is the sort of stuff they would have been able to pull from our systems. And so, you know, we feel that it was the week where we were working on this, it was very trying, but thank goodness they found it and not someone malicious. But the really ugly thing was a lot of this stuff had been cached by search engines, right? So we had to go around you know, different search engines around the public. So Google was fairly easy to work with, Bing, Yahoo, Yandex, Baidu, DuckDuckGo, and many others, right? So there are, you know, you'll quickly discover there are South Korean search engines which are caching things, and there's some in China, and you know, you've got to do this. So if you think we fixed the bug in 47 minutes, but then you know, like, is an oil spill, right? We've got to clean the oil off of the birds before this looks any better to the public, right? And this private, some of this stuff is information. So what happened with going public about this? Because the other thing was, there's two things going on here. One is our customers, we have to tell our customers at some point, and also to tell the public that something happened, right? Because it's public data. So here's where there's sort of a funny story. So the night it went public, which is February 23rd, so 6 days after we were informed of the problem, it was disclosed. Project Zero disclosed it, we disclosed it a minute afterwards. Another reason why it was very important for us to have the blog post disclosure ready to go, because you're working under time pressure, and the times can change, right? Project Zero initially said, we want to put this on our 90-day disclosure window, which would have been good, because we would have cleaned up more search engines. Then they said, we think this is serious, we need to put it on a 7-day disclosure window. And in fact, they disclosed it on day 6. And so, you know, being ready was very, very important, because had we not been ready, it would have had a very different impression of who we were. We had it all ready to go. But the night it became public, so the night for me, there was a talk being given at Imperial College in London called Don't Panic, Cybersecurity Isn't As Hard As You Think, by me. I had agreed to give this talk long before this ever happened, and I couldn't really pull out of it, so I went to get this talk. The funny thing is, this talk was really about, you know, people choose bad passwords and they don't enable two-factor authentication and all this kind of stuff. This was sort of a general public kind of talk, trying to sensitize people. But I was sitting in this talk thinking, you know, I'm saying these things to these people knowing that I have a team and, you know, we're about to go public with this nightmare situation. So that was at 1900, and at 2300, it was public. So I rushed back home. And the very, very funny thing is that internally at Cloudflare, the CEO said, this is not going to be a big deal. He was in Europe, and I was talking to him. He said, this is not going to be a big deal. A few publications are going to write about it. They're going to be very, very technical publications, and then it's going to blow over. That's the top of the Wall Street Journal the next day. So it was a little bit bigger than people thought. So the thing's public, and as soon as we made it public, we told our customers. Now, we didn't tell our customers before. We didn't inform anybody before it became public, which was a controversial decision internally, because some of our large customers, the large ride-hailing service, the large dating website, you know, they would have liked to have known ahead of time. But it's very difficult to disclose to a small number of people. So things are going to get out, and we were already on a very tight timeline. It was a very serious problem. So we made a decision that we would go public all in one go. And what we did subsequent to that was we called all of our customers. So myself and a number of other people in the company reached out with our customer success team to all of the large customers and anyone else who wanted to speak to us, and spoke to them on the phone. And so basically for about a week, on the technical side, we didn't get a lot of sleep because we were working through everything and making sure everything was sorted out. And then for about another week, we didn't get a lot of sleep because we were doing round the clock phone calls with people. And, you know, what people wanted from us was they wanted to confirm their understanding of what the problem was and what their exposure was. And so what we then did was we said, well, look, we need to go back and look at what actually happened. So we tried to understand how much data could we have leaked. Now, we have various logging systems, and this is where, you know, things get a bit funny. So we know from logging systems that the number of URIs that were hit between these different dates was something like this. And the reason for the different dates is, depending on when we enabled certain features as we were doing the rollout, we leaked more and less stuff. And so based on what we could do, we each leak contained a hell of a lot of Cloudflare stuff, a bit less than a cookie, some small amount of authorization headers, and we didn't find in any search engines anything like passwords, credit cards, or social security numbers. And then what we did is we told our customers, you know, if you're doing this size of traffic through us, since it was random, you're likely to have had this many pages leaked with data in it, so people could understand the scope of it. And so we gave a lot of statistical analysis, and there's a very extensive blog post if anybody wants to know about how we did this to try to determine what was found. I mean, the good thing is we didn't find passwords or credit cards or social security numbers, but we were able to give people an idea of the scope. But the really ugly truth, and this is the thing that really gets me personally as a CTO, is this. We rolled out these different features between September and February the 18th. And it was on September the 22nd that the leak started. Right, so we started because we'd moved this feature over into the new parser. And at the beginning, you know, there were only a small number of sites that had the flaw and had the features enabled. And that was between September and January, so it was a small number. And then on when we migrated over email obfuscation, a much larger number of sites had the flaw. And actually, this is when Project Zero began to notice it, because we were leaking much more stuff. And the thing is, this had been going on for months. So this is core dumps of our Nginx software on our edge. We were recording the core dumps. We had the statistics that showed us what stuff was happening. And we can see the core dumps jump up the very day that we shipped the new version of the software. And we didn't look at this. And this is, you know, when you look at the organizational failing or what, you know, how did this happen? Well, okay, bad software gets written, stuff gets rolled out. We had the data to have spotted it. And I think that was a bit where we were feeling bad. So what happened? Well, obviously, I then turned around and said, look, guys, we're never going to do this again. If there are production crashes of software, we're going to take it very seriously. And I said, there's going to be zero tolerance. And in fact, initially, every crash I have to know about personally. And we have to fix them. And so what happened was, if you look at this is an actual graph of crashes of our Nginx software in production. You can see these peaks of different things where, you know, Cloudbleed happens. Now, it varies because people fix their web pages, right? People fix the broken HTML, so sometimes they stop us crashing. But, you know, it actually becomes disclosed, and then it goes down to a very, very low number but it's not zero, right? And we're like, what the hell is this? Why is it not zero? We fixed all these things. We had this massive effort. Every time there was a crash, we stopped the world, essentially, in engineering and put people on it and fixed it and rolled out new software until it just went down and down and down and down. We didn't find another Cloudbleed, but we fixed a load of crashes that could perhaps one day have been that. But there was this mystery thing going on, and the engineers working on it were saying, this doesn't make any sense, right? This doesn't make any sense. The Nginx crashes, but it can't crash in that particular location. You know, the instruction is not one that can crash on the processor. You know, are we dealing with cosmic rays? And somebody said, that's a cop-out. That's nonsense. It's not that. There's something else. And the comment that really got everybody was this one. The bad value just seems to come out of nowhere. Like, how the hell can that happen? How can the machine crash? And, you know, there were mysteries, right? If you looked into the core dump, you know, the instructions and the state of memory didn't explain what was in the registers, or the register state couldn't explain the memory state, or, you know, you'd get to a point where it dies on a, we even saw a crash on a NOP instruction. So we're like, how the hell can that happen? How can the machine crash on a NOP instruction? And so none of it seemed to make sense, or it didn't match the signal information. So the operating system would say it crashed like this, and the core dump would say it crashed like this. And so on average, we were getting one mystery core dump a day over, you know, thousands of machines globally, right? Scattered all over the world. So per server, 1 in 10 years, it would crash. So very hard to reproduce because you can't wait 10 years. It's like, oh, it happened. You know, so we had to try things out. So hard for us to try any fix. And, you know, we'd see stuff like this, which is like the bottom one is what the kernel says, and then the core dump says this, and they don't match. And so we thought, could this be a Linux kernel bug? There's something going on in the Linux kernel. So we went off, and we went down a whole road of looking at kernel things. But there were no bugs like this reported upstream. We actually went through the code, we did a manual inspection, no correlation with the metrics. And then someone said, well, could this be hardware? And this is the really fascinating thing, where someone said, actually, it turns out this only happens on Broadwell. Only the machines that have Broadwell have this problem. And we verified that fairly quickly, because we could look at the crashes across the system. And then we went to Intel and got this lovely thing, specification update, which is actually errata, right? Stuff that's wrong with the processor. And we started looking for, could something like this happen? And sure enough, there's this bug, BDF76, under a complex series of events, when running hyperthreading, which we do, a correctable internal parity error or unpredictable system behavior may occur. So I sort of, you know, that's burying the lead right there. By the way, your processor might just freak out, right? And we went back and was like, what microcode level are we running on our processes? Oh, well, we're two back. Because, of course, one of the things about microcode updates, and this has really happened with Meltdown and Spectre, is you typically get them through the people who make the machine, and it comes with a BIOS update, or maybe through the operating system, and you know, you update over time. And so this is another example of a bit of software that needed updating, in this case, inside the processor. And so what we did was we said, right, well, we're going to roll out this new microcode update and see if this problem goes away. And this is what happened. Guess where we rolled out the microcode update? So that was the crashes, fleet-wide crashes. Boom. Gone. So since then, now, the reason we wanted to do this is it's very, very easy for engineers in the presence of this kind of bug, when there's a crash, to say, oh, it's that crash. It's probably that weird thing. I don't want to look at it. Whereas if you get it to zero, now today when something crashes, people are on it. Like, what's that? Because we know it's not hardware. We know it's software. And it's not cosmic rays. Right? There's been work done on cosmic rays. We use ECC memory. It's very unlikely that's going to happen. So to sum up, so some thoughts on this. It really mattered to us to be as transparent as possible about this. And in fact, just a funny story about this is there's a very large company in Berlin that invited me to come and give a talk, essentially this talk, about this to the company. And I was flying to Berlin, and I said to the sales guy, I didn't know these guys were a customer. And he's like, they're not. I'm like, well, why am I going to give them, you know, why have they invited us to give this talk? And they got their whole engineering team together, about 1,000 people, to hear this talk. And I said to the guy who was the VP of engineering at the end, why did you do this? And he said, well, we've been with a competitor, and in your disclosure of what happened, you gave more information than we've had from them in 10 years. And we looked at it and said, if we had a problem like that, we'd want to be like that. We want to work with those guys, because they were transparent and told us what happened, were truthful. And they are now actually a customer, they switched. So I think being transparent really mattered. It slowed us down a little bit. We had a bad security bug, and some customers were very upset. But in fact, transparency helps things. Cooperate with security researchers. I mean, it's not rocket science. Don't fight them. I mean, honestly, Project Zero, it was a very tough week. There were moments when I was like, oh, I wish they'd do this, or wish they'd do that. But I mean, I feel like we were saved. If a malicious hacker had found that and had just been sitting siphoning off memory, I mean, that would have been company killing. Start taking notes immediately. Right? Very, very, very communicate. Very, very important, because you'll just forget. I mean, it was 1 o'clock in the morning for me, I was going to forget. Over communicate. So, you know, we put out a public blog post. We answered questions in public forums, you know, just as openly as we could. We called our customers and talked to them. And last thing, go back and see if hindsight was 2020. I mean, we had the data to stop this. We could have stopped this in September. Maybe it would have lasted 2 days before we figured out what was happening. Instead, it lasted for months. And I think, you know, everybody's got log files, crash data, information they can go look at. So I think that was a big learning for us. Thank you very much. And I think we have time, so I'm happy to answer questions if people want to know.
Hi. Given that you've had to go back and like logs you say that were there and everything and like the BIOS updates and all that, have you had to change your process of how you look at bug fixes and crashes now? Because it seems like some of that stuff should have been like, oh, well, we should have checked to see if there were updates or whatnot that needed to be done before we went forward and look at this other stuff.
Yeah, so there's a few things, right? So on the hardware side of things, we were definitely very much relying on the vendor who sells. So we have machines made for us in Taiwan by an ODM, and we were very much relying on them in terms of the firmware on the processor. And that's changed. So you know, the team that manages the data centers is on top of what's happening on Intel in terms of those kind of things. Bear in mind, the Intel Broadwell thing was not causing this security bug. It was causing our machines to crash, but it wasn't the security problem, right? So it was different. The security problem was our fault. Completely. In terms of software development, yes, of course, in terms of the crashing, that's been taken extremely, extremely seriously. And there were other things we did around. We did a comprehensive look at, you know, were we consistently using address space randomization across our, you know, all of the software we're using? Were we consistently using static code analysis? There was a bunch of things we did around, you know, cleanliness, I guess, of the code we're producing. The other thing we did is we continued a migration away from memory unsafe languages. So some parts of our code are Nginx, C, and there's not much you can do about it, but there's been a big bias away from using things like C because of, you know, inherently, it was interesting to see, you know, how easy it was for us to create this situation by missing one keyword in Regel.
So I'm really interested in the mentality change, because I'm totally familiar with, oh yeah, it's that mystery crash, you know. So when a certain level of error gets into the process, people become inured to it. And I'm really wondering, okay, so maybe you guys solved it in this respect, but it's a bigger problem just about mentality, and I'm wondering what you think about that.
No, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, I was the guy who always used to compile C code with warnings as errors, because I always thought warnings, you know, themselves were ought to be treated like errors, and we ought to get to absolute cleanliness, because then you know, right, what's happening. And within the company, there were different groups of engineers with different mentalities about that. So we had various systems that were reporting errors, or, you know, when we're compiling something, are there warnings and lots of things. And I think it was a big wake-up call. I think the fact that we could go back and say this was happening in the past was a big wake-up call. And then once you have a metric where you're actually a graph, and you know that myself and maybe even the CEO is looking at a graph that shows how many crashes you've had or something, that focuses people's mind. You're actually measuring it, right? So I think measuring it helped it. But I mean, I totally agree. I mean, I think it's very easy. You know, the classic one is the flaky test case. And so for a long time, I worked on Cloudflare's DNS server. We run our own DNS infrastructure. We wrote our own server. And we're obsessed with that thing when we do upgrades being absolutely perfect in terms of how it replies to DNS. Because DNS has so many weird end cases and stuff going on. So we had this huge test suite. And then, you know, there would be some test cases that were flaky. And I would just like, fix them, you know. Either remove them or fix them. You can't have this situation where sometimes the test suite fails, because otherwise people get completely immune to it. So I think it's very, very important. It's, you know, it's just about being clean throughout.
Do you have a communication route that you wish Tavis had rather used rather than a public tweet?
I mean, he could have emailed us. I think he probably knew people on the team. But, I mean, it got the attention of multiple people in the company, because multiple people in the company follow me on Twitter. And so, you know, it'd be easy to say, right, gosh, I wish he had privately emailed us so this wasn't public, so people weren't watching. On the other hand, by being public, I think probably about 5 or 6 people immediately saw that. And you could imagine an email being sent to one person, disappearing into an email box and not getting replied to, because it was Friday evening, right, in the US. So the thing with the Project Zero thing is, when you're in the fog of it, there are things where you think, God, I wish this had happened, and I wish this had happened. But when you step back, you're like, look, that you can argue about communication of different things, but this was a very serious bug. And they found it, and they told us.
Yeah.
So I don't feel like going back and being like, oh, I wish he'd sent me an email at this time of the day, or, you know, what would have been nice if we'd had a little longer to clean up the search engines? Because when it became public and there was data people could find in search engines, that was harrowing. But even that, right, that data was out there. So it's better to disclose it. And, you know, it was a hell of a bad 2 weeks for me and a lot of other people. Because, you know, you don't know what's going on. Then you do know what's going on. That's even more terrifying. Then you've got to talk to people about it as openly as possible. But it's better to have just got it out there. And I really believe that, you know, whether it was 6 days or 7 days or 8 days, telling everybody as openly as we could. And some of those conversations were hard. You know, I talked to some customers who were really, really upset. And I talked to some others who were like, we don't even care that you leaked all our cookies. We just invalidated everything, right? So.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for coming.